My name is Stanislaw Robert Liberta with AV Ultra, and today we're going to be talking all about cameras. In part one, we're going to be working with viewpoint cameras, framing cameras, depth of field, near and far fade, focus, and zoom to behaviors. If you're comfortable with cameras, I recommend jumping right into part two, where we actually create a whole project from beginning to end using cameras, drop zones, and a bunch of other exciting things, and it's going to look a little something like this. So let's go ahead and let's get started. When you open up 12A, you're going to be greeted with something like this. And I just have a 3D layer here in space and a few other things. In Apple Motion, we really have two different kinds of cameras. We have a framing camera and a viewpoint camera. And right now I have these two in my O1 camera types. And if I turn one off and I turn the other one on, it doesn't really look like we're seeing much difference. And that's okay, because to really see the difference between these two cameras, we're going to have to change our perspective. So let's go ahead and change from a framing camera to our perspective. And right away, we can see a few different things. You can see I have my 2D background. I have some other things going on. We're going to ignore that for right now. And let's talk about our framing camera. I'm going to zoom out just a bit. And our framing camera does exactly what it sounds like. All our camera control is based upon what is being framed into our scene. So if I go under my framing camera, and I go under my properties, we have our rotation, X, Y control, etc. Let's just jump right down into the rotation controls. And if I turn any of these things, see what's happening. Our locus of control is based upon what is being framed into the scene. If I'm rotating anything, it's rotating around the object that is really being framed. When we're talking about animation and how we're actually animating, that's pretty intuitive, but that's not really the way cameras tend to work. If I turn off my framing camera and I turn on my viewpoint camera, our controls now are based upon our camera. So imagine you are a camera person and you are sitting next to your camera. Typically, the way you're rotating them is like this. And you'll notice what happens if I do that in my scene, my viewpoint control is a little bit more natural. It can be admittedly a little tough to animate with. So if we're actually animating, I like to use the framing camera. If we're moving a virtual camera through a scene that contains a lot of video footage that we're stacking in 3D space, that's where I'm going to be using my viewpoint camera. An example would be if I had some text like my AV Ultra camera tests, and I really wanted to frame that up. And so if I use my controls here to frame this up, we'll go to our viewpoint camera and change this to a fit. Here I can back away and it feels a little bit more natural as I'm animating. So that is the main difference between the framing camera and a viewpoint camera. The main difference is where exactly that control is coming from. One more important thing to be aware of with our framing and our viewpoint cameras is what happens when we change our angle of view. For example, if I change my framing camera here from a 45 degree to something like 100 degree, you can see what's happening in our framing camera preview. It is moving back, but really that disc in the back, our Siemens star, isn't really changing at all. If I scroll all the way back to about 10 degrees, now you can actually see my text layer. And what's happening is our camera is moving really far back in space. I'm going to turn off that other layer in the background for right now. And if I go back to my framing camera and I just start scrolling this back and forth, our view is changing based upon our angle here. If I turn that off and I turn on my viewpoint camera, check out what happens. This works a little bit more like a real camera would. If I am changing that angle of view to something very, very narrow, it's almost like doing a zoom in. Everything is becoming very compressed. So I come up to my HUD, I can see a focal length. So this is a pretty close approximation, but it still doesn't give me that same kind of control where I would have my f-stop in After Effects. So be aware of that, that it's not really a true representation of focal length. So those are the main differences between framing and viewpoint cameras. Let's go ahead and move on to our depth of field. So I'm going to turn off this camera here, and that's pretty important. Make sure these two top cameras are off. And we're going to turn on our depth of field camera. I'm just going to select my depth of field, and I'm going to hit F. And what F does is that zooms in to the view of this layer. So this layer is comprised of this disk and this text layer, and it is showing me everything to fit into my screen. And I'm just gonna zoom that out just a little bit and select my depth of field camera. Our depth of field camera has some different things. First of all, it's a framing camera, and that's what we're gonna be using by default. We have these three different squares. We've got this front square, this middle square, and off in the back, we've got this far square. So if I zoom around here, we can kind of see that a little bit clearer. And this really denotes what is in focus and what's out of focus and where is like the furthest kind of focus that we have. If I use my HUD to kind of zoom in and zoom out, by the way, this is the same kind of controls that we have in the top right corner, I'm not really getting any kind of depth of field at all. Really, I'm just seeing what I would normally see. And the reason for that is we need to turn on our depth of field in our renderer. If I turn that on and now I zoom in, you'll notice that things are really getting out of focus. And if I pull back, my text is coming into focus and then resting right about there, and that's in focus. Well, I can see that right now my text is falling in between these two squares. And off in the distance, that's still in focus, and that's somewhere in this square here too. If I zoom in and get this within those two squares, now this is in focus. And if I keep going beyond that, you'll notice that it's getting out of focus again. So let's talk about how we're setting this focus. I'm gonna just zoom out really far for right now, just so we have our text in focus and our background out of focus. Let's go ahead and take a look through our active camera. This is what we saw in our front and middle square. In the background though, this was all the way out past that third square. Maybe to illustrate this better, we're gonna turn on two views. Right now, I have a few different things happening. I have a depth of field blur amount that I can actually turn down or dial up. The higher this goes, the more blurry that background is going to be or anything that's not in focus. We also have our focus offset. So if I scrub this back and forth, pay attention to what's happening here. I'm really taking that focus and racking it between these two different points. And if I keep scrolling forward, that now this is in focus and this is really out of focus. So this is telling me that the focus here is pretty shallow. Only things between these two areas are in focus. Well, if I want to change that, I can actually dial this all the way forward and back. And this is my near focus. This is saying, hey, this is the closest thing that's gonna be in focus to the camera. And notice I can take this all the way up, and now I have a very wide depth of field. So right now, everything between this point and this point is in focus. I can change that offset and change that. So as soon as things move past that near focus, they're becoming out of focus. And the same with this back plane for when I move this all the way back. And once that hits that threshold of moving this all the way out of focus, well, now everything is unreadable. So let's go ahead and put that back. We also have a far focus, and our far focus will let us set that really far path. So we talked about our near focus, and that's setting how wide our focus is. And then our far focus lets us set the maximum focus value. I can crank this back up beyond it to pull everything in focus. Now, maybe I just want infinite focus in the back. I don't want to worry about what's in between here and this middle section and that front section with my focus offset. I really just want this and this. And that's where we have this infinite focus. And as soon as I click that, it does exactly what it sounds like. It's going to extend out that camera's rear focus forever. So now all we have to worry about is setting our near focus. And our near focus works a little bit more what you would imagine a real camera to work like. So let's go ahead and move on to our filter types. I'm gonna turn off that infinite focus right now. When we are blurring things out, if I set this focus offset, and we're gonna just dial this way back so we get that Siemens star out of focus. Take a look at exactly what's happening. And we're gonna zoom that in just so we can kind of see that a little bit more clearer. Come back to my depth of field and let's talk about this filter type. Right now it's set to Gaussian, and really that's just a blur. There's not a lot of computation, it's just taking the pixels and blurring them. But if I change this to a defocus, now I get something really interesting happening. Right now it's set to disk, or I can set it to polygon. And when I set things to polygon, I can actually set the number of sides in the polygon. So this works a lot like different kinds of lenses that will have a different number of blades inside to create their bokeh blur. If I zoom this in and zoom this out, we get a different kind of blur that we would normally not get using the Gaussian blur. The trade-off with this is that it's a little bit harder to compute and takes a little bit more time to render, but tends to look a little bit more believable. So let's go ahead and move on to the next section. I'm gonna turn off my depth of field camera, close our depth of field, turn that off, and we're gonna come down to our near and far fade. So I'm just going to click on my near and far fade. I've just changed my perspective viewpoint here so I can see this a little bit more clear. And I'm gonna go ahead and click my active camera. And I wanna make sure that I turn on my infinity fade camera. And I turned on my infinity fade, and here's what we see. We have our depth of field, and I'm gonna just turn that off for right now. And we have a near fade and a far fade. And we have a little Apple Motion logo with a floor and some background. I'm gonna just zoom this back out so we can see that a little bit more clear. And in our infinity fade, we're back in our camera controls and we have our near plane, our far plane, our near fade and far fade. So what this means is exactly how much you can see if something gets too close to the camera. As an example, I'm just going to pull the camera back and pull it forward. I'm still hitting these letters that are kind of in my way. It'd be great as if I could zoom in and they would kind of just fade away, or the background would fade in. So let's turn off our infinity fade and let's turn on our near far camera. Right away, my camera looks like it was kind of in the same place here, but it looks totally different. The big difference that we have here is we've set our near and our far fade and our near and our far plane. If I move this far plane back, you can see more is being revealed. So if I pull this back to, let's say, 400, now if I zoom in with my camera, the background slowly fades in depending on the position of the camera. So as I get closer, it starts to fade in. And as I get further away, it fades out. So how exactly do we set this up? I have this near plane, and that's where we start seeing things. So this is going to be about 945 pixels away from the front of the camera. That's when we start seeing things. It also takes into account how many pixels start fading away. At 0, it starts fading away. At 200 or 400, it starts blurring out. This is almost like a feathered edge to our camera. And so again, if I take this near plane and I pull this back, 2000 pixels from here out starts fading away. And the same with the back. If I start pulling this back, it's almost working in the opposite way where it starts coming from the back forward. And I can keep pulling this back until everything gets kind of faded away. If I take this far plane, this is exactly what it sounds like. The further back we go, the more we can see. So if I want to kind of hide something in the background like this, I can do that and then just fade into things. So this is great, especially if I was doing a bit of a slideshow or if I wanted to have text moving into my scene and I had a lot of text in the background, I don't want to be able to see it all. I want it to fade in and fade out kind of naturally. Let's take a look at some special behaviors that some cameras can have. Right now I have a camera focus and we have a zoom to behavior and a focus behavior. Let's turn off the camera in our number 3. And we're gonna turn on the rest of the layer. So we still have our near far and our icon and our floor and our backdrop. And I'm gonna go to my zoom to behavior and let's just see what's happening. So if I select my zoom to behavior camera and I just play this back, we can see what's happening. So let's do that one more time. Check out what's happening here in my perspective window. If I play this back, it is moving onto the scene and then zooming. But notice it's really only the background that's changing. The foreground isn't changing. So it's kind of like a Hitchcock zoom that we have immediately. And so that's really cool because otherwise what I would have to do is manually change my angle of view and what I'm framing at the same time. It's extremely efficient when I want to get this kind of a look, but I'll be honest, I don't really use it as often as I feel like I could be or I should be. Another behavior that we have specialty to cameras is the focus behavior. This is probably one of my favorite behaviors as far as cameras. I really like the framing and sweeps, but focus behavior does something really cool. So I'm just going to select my focus behavior camera, and I'm making sure I have that selected. And we're gonna make sure that we have this fit to view. And what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna play this back and see what's happening here and in my other screen. I'm gonna have to turn on my depth of field for this example. And right now I have my near fade out of focus. And let's do a quick RAM preview so we can see what this looks like. Okay, so most of that's rendered out, and I'm just going to open up my focus behavior layers, and we can see what's happening. So I have one focus behavior here, and then a second one here. So let's play back just this first one. And what's happening is our focus is moving from this far fade to our near fade. And so what it's automatically doing is I grabbed whatever layer I want in focus, and then it does that immediately. If I want to change how fast it does it, I can do that with an ease, ease in, ease out, accelerate, and its transition speed. So this will change how fast that it actually gets into focus. So right now it's very, very quick. Going to undo that. And I also just copied this behavior by hitting Command D. And I've got this one here, and I just dragged that other layer directly into it. To show you exactly what I did was I went into my near-far focus, I grabbed my Apple icon, and I just dragged that right in there. To show you what that looks like, first I have my far fade, then my near fade, then my motion icon. If I want this to slow down as it goes into that rack focus, I can just extend that out. And this time we're going to ease both of these, give its transition about 75%. And I'm just gonna RAM preview that one more time. So now that goes out of focus very quickly. And then it eases into that final focus. There's lots of other things that we can do with our cameras and behaviors. If I wanted to give this a bit of a camera shake, I'm just gonna turn down my quality, turn off my reflections and depth of field for right now, and come on down to my behaviors and add something called a wriggle. I'm actually gonna go into the inspector to change this, and I'm gonna dial this up to about 400, and we're gonna change our frequency down to, let's say, 0.5. What I wanna do is I wanna apply this to a specific property and our position. And right now, we're just gonna do X and Y. Right now, if I play this back, you can see what's happening. It's moving around quite erratically. Maybe I don't want it to move around that fast. I'll dial this down to 0.2 and instead change it to about 35, right? And again, maybe that's still a little too much. Maybe I wanna turn down my noisiness. And maybe I want to change this to 0.1. We can see what's happening here. We're getting this really nice smooth motion. And so this is great for creating some realistic kind of movement. And it's extremely useful to just be able to throw that in there and give it some random parameters. My name is Stanislaw Robert Liberto with AV Ultra. And that is the end of cameras part one. In our next lesson, we're going to be animating a camera in 3D space and creating a little 15 second intro. So be sure to come back and check that out. As always, I hope you found this information useful.